tinted glass.
Woo! Gang, welcome to Death Curse Society. We're back with a whole new episode. We got a whole lot to talk to you about tonight. It's going to be a lot of fun. I'm your host, Red Crank. I got the Colonel, and I got Zigzag.
Woo-hoo!
Zigzag's doing shots already for some reason.
Shots.
It's party time here.
Death Curse Society, baby. The party's in the house.
Yeah, the party's already here. We're going to be talking about the new Scary Stories to Tell in the Dark trailer that just dropped. We're also going to look at the 47 Meters Down Uncaged trailer, Ready or Not trailer, and the Hoax trailer. If you haven't seen this, kind of interesting. We're going to be talking about the Ghost Adventures and what they've got planned for the spooky month of October and a couple other things. But before we get started, please make sure if you're watching, hit that subscribe button, hit that notification bell. Don't miss another episode. And now, let's go camping.
You're going to Camp Blood, ain't you? You'll never come back again. It's got a death curse.
All right, for Let's Go Camping this time, we got a real treat for you. Colonel went out and got an exclusive interview with David Howard Thornton, Art the Clown from Terrifier, and we're going to show you a little bit of it. Colonel, talk to us about this, you motherfucker.
So as these guys know, I had the pleasure of making a surprise visit to Days of the Dead, Indianapolis, July 5th, 6th, and 7th. While there, I got to talking to David Howard Thornton. We had a lot in common. We just kind of shooting the shit. I said, hey, man, why don't you come on the show sometime and do an interview for us? Okay, so we're going to have the condensed version for you here on this episode, but keep an eye out on YouTube because we're going to have a very long version, okay? Me and David chatted for about an hour and 45 minutes. Today you're getting 12 minutes of that. So if you want to see two guys just bullshit, do voiceovers, play characters, tell some personal stories, that's where you're going to want the long fucking interview. It was a blast. Oh, it's hard to stay professional and stay on topic with that guy. We had too much fun.
Check it out. We'll watch this and we'll be right back, gang.
Hey, how's it going, Mother Cursors? It's the Colonel here with our very special guest, Art the Clown himself, David Howard Thornton. David, thank you for being with us tonight.
Howdy, Colonel.
Thanks.
Thanks for having me.
So what drove or motivated you to audition for a character like Art the Clown? Because that is a huge change.
Oh, yeah. Well, see, I mean, I would say you need for a job for one. But it was really because I had seen All Hallows Eve before I even saw the audition notice. So I loved the character already because I've always wanted to play a character like that because I love silent comedy, like physical comedy, especially like Marx Brothers or Mr. Bean. And I kind of looked at Art as being like an evil Mr. Bean. And I'm like, oh, my God, I would love to play that kind of character. And so, like, when I saw that audition notice, I was like, hell yes. Okay, I have to do this. This is my role. This is what I'm meant to do. So I told my people to send me in for it. That's why I wanted to do it, because I was like, I knew I could do this role. This is like, I wanted that kind of challenge because it's, you know, I do all these crazy character voices, but I never had an opportunity just to play a silent character like that.
Fair enough. And actually, a follow-up question to that, which you kind of touched on a little bit with the crazy Mr. Bean.
Mm-hmm.
How did you go about getting into character to play Art? Because that's a very demented character.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I mean, I can turn characters on and off as soon as I have an idea of who they are in my mind. I don't have to go full-on Daniel Day-Lewis. I didn't have to do that. Didn't have to send, like, boxes of condoms and dead pigs, like my co-stars, like Jared Leto, or any crazy shit like that. No, just like, I just basically kept in my mind that he was basically the bastard child of Freddy Krueger and Harpo Marx, and that helped me discover who he was as the character. Because I just combined my love of horror villains and my love of silent film and physical actors. Just, that's how I came up with Art. A little bit of Joker in there, of course, too. Crazy uncle.
Yeah. So some of the smiles and the hand movements, I definitely get a Joker vibe from it, which you play an excellent Joker, by the way.
Oh, I thank you. He puts a smile on my face.
A lot of actors will create a backstory for the characters they play. Did you happen to do that for Art?
We did. That's one of the very first things I really discussed with Damien when I was in the makeup chair with him, was like, who is Art? And yeah, at first he didn't really even know. He was like, I just came up with this character because I thought he looked cool for All Hallows Eve. I never really thought about too much into it. And I was like, well, let's discover who he is together. And so we've, over these years, we've really fleshed out his background between the two of us. So we know who he is now.
Okay, now I'm assuming we're going to get a little glimpse into your guys' idea in Terrifier 2. I know you can't spill the beans on much.
Mm-hmm. We'll drop some clues here or there. Maybe some red herrings, too.
Okay, yeah. Fair enough. Because I know I like the mystery to Art.
Yeah, that's what we want to kind of keep there, is that mystery. We don't want to just tell everybody right off the bat who he is and why he's doing what he is doing. I think that little bit of mystery makes him more intriguing that way.
Well, yeah, I agree. So I know a lot of people are caught up wanting to know his backstory. I know I asked you that. I know a lot of people have asked you that before. But I'm a fan of not knowing. So I see Art as just pure chaos.
Yeah.
Look, wreck shit, and he's gone. See
again. Yeah, that's exactly what it is. He's an agent of chaos. So, you know, that's one way we look at him. It's like he loves what he does, and this is his purpose on this planet, is to just cause mayhem and chaos wherever he goes.
What was your favorite scene to film?
Oh, that was the diner, like the pizzeria scene by far. I keep calling it the diner scene because that's originally what it was supposed to be in, but we ended up making a pizzeria. But it's because I got to play around so much in that scene, and you see so many different sides of Art in that scene. You see his, like, clownish side, but then you also see his just, like, just sinister, creepy side, and also his just, like, just violent killer side, too. It was a fun scene. It basically set him up for the audience right there. It's like, that scene tells you exactly what you're in for.
No, I agree with you. It was a fantastic scene. My personal favorite one from the movie, even more than what people call the scene.
Mm-hmm.
It was a great kill. The pizzeria scene, like, it set up the movie perfectly. I couldn't agree with what you said more. An odd question I have about that scene. I know I'm going way out of the realm of just enjoying the movie.
Mm-hmm.
As we all know, Art gets up, does his little happy walk to the bathroom, decides to smear feces all over the restroom.
Yeah.
My question is, how come at the beginning of the film, no one could smell him coming? Like, she has smelled him getting into the car.
Yeah.
That's still pretty fresh.
Yeah. Lots of Febreze.
Yeah. That's some good air freshener.
Yeah, I never thought of that. I was like, yeah, you know, she would smell that poop. As soon as he opened the car, he was like, whoa, God. And he's like, Don, not Don, but Tara, what did you do in there? What did you eat? Oh, ah! That would have been funny for her to, like, Tara, what did you, ah!
There is a very dark, twisted, I like to call it, gore galore film.
Gore galore, I like that.
Gore galore. Hashtag, you know, I need to trademark it like Gene Simmons before anybody else uses it. But what did you and the cast do to kind of ease the tension behind the camera?
Oh, we were just always joking around. Like, it's like just constantly. I always like to try to keep things light, those kind of situations too. It's like we're doing so many horrible, horrible, violent, scary, nasty, disturbing things. And I wanted to kind of counterbalance that with, like, jokes and, you know, just keeping things light on set. So that's what we did. A lot of jokes. I mean, I think Samantha, like, recorded me a lot just goofing around on set. I don't know whatever happened to those videos, but I'm sure there's some damning stuff out there.
Well, hopefully with the Steelbook version coming out, I believe, here shortly.
Yeah.
Maybe she can let those resurface.
Oh, that would be great. Footage. I would love that.
Did you have a favorite weapon in Bart's? Bart's. Hey, Bert. We'll just keep going.
Yeah,
Bart's magical bag, as I like to call it.
Oh, gosh. I would say that kind of nine tails is probably my favorite, too, because I thought it's a very unique weapon. I think that's probably more like his signature weapon than, I mean, most people think it's a hacksaw. I think this one's his signature weapon because, if you're paying attention at the beginning of the movie, you see what it's actually made of if you're really, really paying attention. And like the, each strand of the nine tails is made out of human hair from his victims. So it's just like, I think that's what's really cool. It's like he's made this whole flagellum out of, you know, all these different cutting devices. It's just, it's sick. That would do some damage to someone.
Oh, it really would. I mean, it's like I said at the beginning of the film, you see him painstakingly taking his time crafting this weapon. Yeah. You got the scalpel, a pair of scissors. I'm trying to think what else I've seen on there.
Just little bits of everything.
And like I said, the hair, that's a nice touch.
Yeah.
Like I said, I can't get enough of it. It's such an original weapon.
Yeah.
It's fantastic. It's brutal as hell. So I've heard the story before, so I want to ask for it again. So I absolutely love it.
Yeah.
Your story about Art the Clown meets New Jersey's Finest. Don't know. Would you mind telling this story? Because this is absolutely hilarious.
Oh, sure. Yeah. It was like one night. It was about 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock in the morning. It's the night we were filming the whole gun scene. And Jenna's in there filming. I'm bored. I'm already in full makeup and costume. I've got blood all over me. And these two women decide to have this very Jerry Springer-ish like argument on the street right outside of my window. And I'm like, oh, well, I'm bored. I'll go watch this. This should be entertaining. And I forget how I look. And so I'm just sitting there just like watching, and one of them looks up and sees me in mid argument and sees me, and I just wave at her, forgetting how I look. I'm like, hi. And she just screams. The other one turns, sees me, screams, and go running off. And I'm like, well, that was entertaining. And about 10, 15 minutes later, Damien and our producers and everybody come in. They're like, Dave, we got some people here want to meet you. I'm like, oh, cool. Who's here? Because like our producer Phil at the time was doing a movie with Tom Sizemore, so I figured maybe Tom Sizemore had dropped by the set. So I'm like, oh, that would be awesome. So they're like, just don't come out until we tell you. I'm like, okay, guys, cool. And there was like this big roll-up garage door some way down the other side, and they're like, Dave, come on out. So I roll it up, and I come up, and I see like a 10 to 15 of New Jersey's Finest in like full on riot gear. And there's like this moment of silence. And I just felt my butt just pucker. I'm just like, ah! And I just squeaked out this little, what's up, guys? And there's still silence. And then they all just start busting out laughing. And I'm like, oh God. They're like, yeah, you better be glad he didn't come out here first. We would have shot you on sight. I believe it. And the bad thing was we had our porta potty out there because we didn't have running water in that building, so we had to use a porta potty outside. So if I had been in that porta potty when they had shown up, I would probably not be here. it was so fun. But then they're all like, you know, having fun with me afterwards, all getting their pictures made. Like there was this one cop that was afraid of clowns, so he would not go near me, and the other ones were ragging him on it. I'm like, dude, you got like a grenade launcher on you. You're fine. He's like, ah, it's okay, man. It's okay. And like one even offered to bring us a body from the station if we needed a dead body. And I still don't know to this day if he was joking or not. So I'm like, oh, wow, yeah, we got a body at the station right now. If you guys need one, we could bring it down to you. I'm like, yeah, that's okay. That's okay.
That's not good.
That's good, man. But yeah, that was a fun night, though. It's just like, those are the things you can't write.
David, that's going to wrap it up for us here. I appreciate you coming on to the show. The Death Curse Society appreciates it. And all the sick and twisted mother curses that watch the show, I'm sure appreciate it.
Well, I appreciate it, too. Thank you very much for having me.
So there's 12 minutes of Art the Clown goodness right there. That guy seems pretty cool. I'm glad you were able to meet up with him and connect in that way, Colonel. I like it. Zag, what do you got about this?
I'm hip, man. I just love the fact that he really seems to embrace the fact that he's got a hold of the brass ring as far as standing with some of the elite fucking horror icons in our world. I don't know, Colonel. How did that feel? I mean, you got into, there was a little bit there, but what else did you get out of it that you just tell that he's taking this fucking character and running with it?
Not only did he tell us a story about the meeting New Jersey's finest. Also got a story about him not knowing what a cock sock was and showing up on set with a white tube sock instead for the infamous boob scene when he dressed in Jared. That was pretty funny. Like I said, yeah, he's just loving that he is Art the Clown. He absolutely adores it. He loves it. He believes in that character and that franchise so much.
I have to ask. I know he probably didn't say shit, but did he say anything compared to the scene? Did he talk about what they might do in the new scene? Or like the scale of it, how much bigger it could be? Anything? Anything?
Nothing.
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 Duh, curse you, David Howard Thornton.
The movie's not even being filmed yet. They got to keep tight-lipped about some of the stuff, man.
They had a crowdfunding for one scene. They got to have an idea of what it's going to be. I just, you know.
They're not going to tell you that.
Looked like he was having a couple of brewskis there. He might, you know, Colonel got them all loose, man. They were having a few laughs. You know, I trust the Colonel, man. He goes in for that shit.
Really, if you want to know what they have to say about Terrifier 2, you're going to go back to the panel I recorded a few weeks ago. You really got about as much information there as I was able to get out of him on a one-on-one. Mm-hmm. He is not saying shit.
Neither of them are.
They know they got something great, and they, you know, I love it too. I mean, I'm happy they're not saying shit. I'm happy with the surprise and everything of what they're bringing us. Just, you know, they're doing it right. What reason have they given me not to trust them at this point?
Anyway, good job, Colonel. Can't wait to see the full interview. You. We're going to air that here in just a few days, so keep watch on our YouTube page. Like I said, subscribe so you don't miss it. You don't want to miss it. It's going to be a lot of fun.
Exclusive. Thank you, DHT. DHT, baby. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you to David Howard Thornton for coming on the show and giving us a little bit of insight into Art the Clown and Terrifier and a little bit more, it looks like. So we're going to take a quick break. We'll be back with more Death Curse Society right after this. Stick around.
You think that when you die, you go to heaven. You come to us. Goodbye.
Wondershare Filmora is a user-friendly, easy-to-use video editing software which contains hundreds of special effects for video that allows you to easily create a unique visual effect. Head to www.wondershare.net and get started editing now.
This is David Howard Thornton, Mr. Art the Clown himself from the movie Terrifier, and you're watching Death Curse Society.
All right, welcome back to Death Curse Society. You know what? It's time for some stories around the campfire.
I don't want to scare anyone, but I'm going to give it to you straight about Jason.
Come back.
All right, first up on Stories Around the Campfire, we got a new trailer for Scary Stories to Tell in the Dark. This movie's dropping in theaters August 9th. We're pretty excited about it. Check this trailer out, and we're going to let Colonel spooge all over you about it afterwards.
For years, the people in this town told lies about me. They locked me away, called me a monster. They will get the monster they all deserve.
Sarah Bellows' book. When the stories write themselves and it all comes alive. Who came up with all this sick stuff?
Jangling Man is coming.
I'm afraid that we woke something up.
Sarah Bellows is a myth.
Do you know what you have done? You made her angry.
You don't read the book. The book reads you.
I'm afraid I'm gonna die down.
So, guys, that's the new Scary Stories to Tell in the Dark trailer. It's starting to look pretty damn good. Colonel, what do you think about this one?
Man, you guys know what I think. I've been saying this since it was announced. This was my movie of 2019, as far as horror movies go. And it just keeps getting better and better with each trailer. When I was a kid, coming in, learning at horror, there's the Monster Squad with fabulous product placement, Scary Stories Tell in the Dark, Ghostbusters, fucking Goosebumps, and it just kept going on and on from there. I'm telling you, Crank, you're right. After seeing this new trailer, kind of gave me a little bit of a chub on this one. God, I'm thirsty.
Oh, okay. I wasn't sure what that was at the bottom of the screen there for a minute. Speaking of product placement, very nice.
Learned that from the Monster Squad.
Ziggy, what do you think of this new trailer?
This looks like, I'll say it like this, you know, I have been not the strongest supporter of this one. I've been like, okay, it looks like the things from the book, the pictures match and everything like that. This trailer here showed me that it's going to be a little bit better, a little bit scarier than your common Monster Squad type movie or you know, that kind of Goonies buddy movie. That shit looks pretty scary, man. Some of those creatures that they have in it. Can't wait for it. I'm with Colonel. But we'll see, you know. I'm not as excited as he is, obviously, but it does look like it's going to be damn worthy to see. So bring it on. Bring that baby on.
I'm not sure anybody's as excited as the Colonel is, but like he said, this has been the movie he's been waiting for over a year now, almost, it seems like.
It looks like they've done it right. It looks like they took the time to bring out the things that made the book magical back then. And thanks for that. I just hope that they didn't fuck it up and everything comes together like it should. But it looks like a winner from the trailers.
At first, when we heard about the movie, we weren't sure how they were going to tie all the stories together. And they're actually using the book to do that. And I think that's such a good idea. And they're making the book kind of this mythological item. And take the stories in that book are coming to life in that town. And I think that's just such a good idea and a way to encapsulate the story and include all these, all the random little stories into this one big one. I think it's just a good idea.
It reminded me of Neverending Story a little bit too, kind of the way it laid out like that. So, I mean, as he's reading it, the things are happening. So don't fucking read it. Oh, what do you mean you read it? Oh, shit, you know?
I think they're doing a brilliant idea with it, because I mean, if you guys read the books, you know there's no storyline to it. It was just a collection of stories that you read. So the fact that they would make a story out of this random collection of short stories and songs and rhymes and everything else is fantastic. 8-year-old Michael on the inside is fucking thrilled and wondering why he feels a certain way at a certain part of his body.
Did you just use your government name?
Oh shit, I did. So, take that out.
So, Scary Stories to Tell in the Dark drops in theaters August 9th. And it's also going to be our lead topic on our next episode, episode 122. So, stay tuned for that. We're going to have some more to tell you about that. All right, next up on Stories Around the Campfire, we're going to talk about 47 Meters Down, Uncaged, which drops in theaters August 16th. Check out this trailer, and we'll be right back. Woo!
I almost forgot to show you guys what I found this morning.
That's a shark tooth.
Uh-huh.
I am going to take you to a place that no tourist would ever find in a million years. Chance of a lifetime.
Mayan.
They made human sacrifices here.
Ah! There's something there!
How dare you look!
We're going to die down here.
So that's the trailer for another shark movie, 47 Meters Down, Uncaged. Best thing about the trailer for me so far is it was short. Ziggy, what do you got?
I'll say, you know, it looks good. The sharks look really good, but right, you hit it right on the head, man. We've been there, we've done that. I think Crawl is the winner of this type of movie for this summer. We'll go ahead and let you know if it's worth the price. Be the sacrificial lamb on it again. I know it looks good. I mean, a good shark movie. They look more realistic now. It's no Sharknado bullshit, but it just looks like we've been there, done that, been there, done that, been there, done that.
I mean, I personally think they should have stopped making shark movies after Jaws came out, but that's just me. You know, Jaws is like the pinnacle of shark movies. You're not going to redo it again. And if anybody ever gets an idea to fucking remake Jaws, fuck you. I will come and burn your goddamn house down. Colonel, jump in.
I'll jump in. Or let me say, in other words, I'll jump out with 47 no's down that I'm not going to see this film. I see my creature feature for the summer. It was called Crawl. It's fucking fantastic. I have no desire to see 47 meters down uncaged. There should be 47 meters down unreleased because we've seen the story a million times.
Again, it looks fine. You know, if this is your kind of movie, that's your kind of movie. I'm not judging you. It's just not mine. It seems like it's got some good shots, some good scares. I don't see much out of this. I'm going to try to go in with an open mind, and I'll bring you an open conclusion once I've seen it.
This absolutely seems like one of those movies you'll be in there holding your breath, you know, in several of the scenes because, you know, they got this much air in a pocket and their faces are sticking up there. I guess that's kind of a cool effect on you if you're into that thing, you know, but again, we've been there, done it so many times. I'm hoping the gore saves it. Mm-hmm. You know, big sharks, big bites, lots of blood, lots of gore. That's what I want.
Oh, I want to come back here in a few weeks and say I was wrong. 47 Meters Down, Uncaged, comes out August 16th in theaters. Go check it out if it's your thing. Or just watch us and we'll tell you whether or not to go and check it out or not. Next up on Stories Around the Campfire, Ready or Not is in theaters August 23rd, which looks like an interesting flick. Check this out and we'll be right back.
I can't believe that in half an hour, I will be a part of the Ladomas Gaming Dynasty Empire.
Dominion, we prefer Dominion.
I honestly can't wait to be a part of your family. Still
there's just one more thing, and then you are officially part of the family. So, at midnight, you have to play a game.
Why?
It's just something we do when someone new joins the family.
A game. What game? Hide and seek? Are we really gonna play that?
Well, the rules are simple. You can hide anywhere. We then try to find you.
So there's no way for me to win, right?
And stay hidden till dawn.
No, thank you.
Good luck.
What the hell is this? How old is this thing?
I know you're in here.
Jesus, you shot the maid.
Does she look like she's wearing a giant white wedding dress, Emily?
Holy shit!
I had to play along so that I can get you out.
It's insane.
They think they have to kill you before sunrise, or something very bad will happen to the family.
If we don't find her and perform the ritual, we're all dead.
Found her.
God damn it, Emily!
I don't know what I'm doing!
Today's video is called Getting to Know Your Crossbow.
I forgot my gun.
Why don't you just use mine?
Mr. Ladomas, I just saw her running.
Oh my god!
Fuck your fucking family!
You're just another sacrifice.
Do you think this is a fucking game?
Yes, hide and seek. Remember?
He wanted to get married.
Someone's
no, I'm sorry.
Bully,
I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
So ready or not, here they come. Yeah, I'm intrigued. I'm interested slightly in this one. There seems to be a fun element of this one that I don't see in many horror movie trailers. This one seems to almost kind of make fun of itself in a way. or make fun of the horror genre in a way, because there seems to be a lot of humor, even in the trailer itself. And whatever this family is, they are terrible gun owners. I don't think they should own guns, because they're accidentally shooting people in the head and spearing somebody through the mouth with a crossbow. No, you need to put this shit away and stay away from any firearms. You're not good with them. I do like the idea of the family having this ritual, though. That's kind of a new thing, and I wonder how many times they've done this. You know, that's what is intriguing to me. Colonel, won't you jump in here and talk about your thoughts on the trailer?
Kevin, thoughts on the trailer, ready or not? I was not ready, but no matter what, here it comes. Because this movie came out of left field for me. I hadn't even heard about this movie until about a month and a half, 2 months ago. Bam. There's a trailer. Now, I've seen this trailer probably half a dozen times, if not more, and it looks fucking hilarious. Like, I am really looking forward to this film. I gotta see it.
Yeah, the word is absolutely fun. It looks fun, you know? I mean, conceptually, this looks like the horrible idea of a movie. I mean, it's like dumb, you know, if you take it at face value. But then you watch the trailer and you see that's the inept rich kids that don't know what the fuck they're doing. They can't, you know, everything's taken care of them their whole fucking lives, so they don't know how to use the weapons good. And they're taking each other out. Now, that's my fucking alley. I'm into that. So looks like the victim here is going to actually make fools of all the rich, stupid, inexperienced kids that, you know, think they know what the fuck they know, and they don't know shit. So on that aspect, it looks fun, and I'm into it. So, yes.
You bring up an interesting point there. I wonder what the pitch for this movie was.
If she survives, she's in.
I don't see that many producers going, well, fuck yeah.
Yeah, well, that's the problem. A lot of producers would be like, no. Tell you what would be awesome, though. Let's do a remake of Jaws.
Yeah, you're exactly right. And that's one of the reasons why I want to give this movie a chance. You know, it's different. Ready or Not drops in theaters August 23rd. Grab a date, grab some popcorn, and go check it out. Another trailer to check out on Stories Around the Campfire, Hoax. If you have not seen a decent Bigfoot horror movie, and I really haven't, I've seen some shitty ones, check this out. This might be the one.
I'm going to give it to you straight about Bigfoot. Some kind of demented creature, always on the hunt for intruders, looking to kill, to devour, thirsty for blood.
I'm a TV producer, putting a team together to investigate what happened up there. This is Dr. Ellen Fries. She's our primate specialist. That's Peter Moore, renowned cryptozoologist. Over by the helicopter is Mr. Singer. He's on loan as security.
This undiscovered primate can come in many forms. Of course, there's footprints. Often there is a strong skunk-like odor.
We should go.
It's walking upright.
You are gonna need a bigger banana.
Got anything?
50 meters away.
It's right over there. There's something moving, I don't know what it is. Ta-da!
Hoax is coming out on video on demand and DVD August 20th. Colonel, talk to us about your thoughts on Hoax.
Hey, I'm kind of stoked for Hoax. I mean, I'm a little bit of a believer in Bigfoot. It's 50-50. We've never seen one. And Mulder and Scully have taught me, if anything, I want to believe. Plus, it looks gory as fuck, and you got the badass motherfucker with his big-ass chin from Cobra.
I forgot I saw him in that. That's great. Ziggy, what do you think of Hoax?
Yeah, Bigfoot movies, you know, there's been a lot of them. I mean, there were some titles even back in the 70s and early 80s about Bigfoot, but nothing is ever great, and it's usually you never saw anything.
Yeah.
This one looks a little different. It looks like they borrowed some things from a couple of movies. You got Predator. I saw some of the stuff in there, like the approach, the jungle thing. And then the technology looked straight out of Aliens to me, you know, the little thing where he's reading the meter and stuff. I love the concept. I love the Cobra villain being in charge as a badass. How bad could it be? I don't know, man. Like I said, these Bigfoot movies, there have been a couple attempts. We had Bobcat Goldthwait make one. That's supposed to be the definitive Bigfoot movie, but we're still waiting on this motherfucker. Stay at home, you can get your pizza, get your bowl, pack your bowl, get your six pack, sit back and check it out, man. Colonel mentioned gore. You add gore to the Predator and to the aliens, and bam, we got something happening here, man.
Bring it on. I'm definitely intrigued by it as well. My brother is the real Bigfoot fan in my family, so maybe he'll even be interested in that. So I'm going to check it out, though, because I like the idea, and it does look like an above-average flick. But beforehand, I'm going to have to go see Cobra again, because I haven't seen that bitch in a long time.
It's awesome. I fucking love Cobra.
And I'm the cure.
But Hoax comes out on video on demand August 20th. Check it out. Next up on Stories Around the Campfire, the Ghost Adventures crew from the Travel Channel have a couple of things planned for October. They have a new miniseries that's going to highlight and feature serial killers from around the country. On Halloween night, they're doing a live lockdown at the Real Conjuring House, the Perrin family home in Arizona. Which could be cool, hopefully. Ziggy, let's let you jump in on this first.
I was a fan of this when they first launched it. The first pilot episode, still watching that scene, it was just a couple of bricks floating up into the air. Made my hair stand up watching those guys run out like a couple of girls screaming all the way through those caverns. It was fucking fantastic and intriguing. But over the years, it's kind of devolved into, hey, Zach, what's the matter? I don't know. I feel good. I can't feel. Every time, man. Every fucking time. So I expect this little mini series to be, hammed out things. You know, if he starts getting possessed by Charles Manson and shit, dude, I'm out. Fuck this shit, I'm out. Hey, man, am I the only one who's not forgotten the box they refused to open for 4 fucking hours?
The Dybbuk box.
Should we open it? I don't know. I think we should open it. Well, let's open it then. All right, let's go. Are you ready? We're going to open it now. You going to open it? Let's do it. You got the cameras ready? All right, everyone get in position. Here we go. We're going to open the box. The box is going to be open. Well, wait a minute. We better not open this box. We better not open the box because some bad things happened with the box. That went on for 4 fucking hours, man. If they don't release Annabelle and start flipping the coins and everything in the fucking house, I'm going to be pissed. So I'm glad they cut it in half. It's going to be 2 hours, but shit, man. Something better fucking happen this year. Or, again, I fuck this shit, I'm up.
I remember that the last Halloween special they did, which was 4 hours of literally that. If you guys missed it or didn't watch it, it was literally that. Colonel, jump in here and talk about the Ghost Adventures crew.
Oh, shit.
You want me to talk about the Ghost Adventures crew? I have much better things to do with my time than watch four fucking frauds going around trying to prove ghosts are real, and they can't fucking prove shit. It's fucking terrible. I know it's reality TV and there's nothing real about it, but if you want to watch something prove ghosts are real on the Travel Channel, do yourself a favor, watch The Haunting. At least it claims that's a reenactment, and the acting is a fucking a lot better, all right? I'm sorry, I'm not going to commit 2 hours on Halloween night, almost favorite day of the fucking year, watching these clowns go in the Conjuring house. Oh, we'll see if we can find it. The motherfucker to get possessed. They're probably going to say fucking Balak and all kinds of shit. I'm sure, when no one's looking, they'll get a nickel and spell fucking Balak out on his fucking skin because he has a fucking iron deficiency, and you're going to see it. Oh, I got scratched by the demon. Come on, man. Get the fuck out of here with this bullshit. If they want to prove it's real, I want this motherfucker to get possessed by Jeffrey Dahmer and start sucking dick. Then I'll believe what they're saying. Fuck this shit, I'm done.
But damn.
But
damn. That's all I got to say about that. Damn. If you guys don't realize this yet, shit's about to go down when Colonel takes the glasses off. It's a big deal around here. I am kind of a fan of Ghost Adventures for some reason. I don't know why. I like the cheesiness of it sometimes. I really am not a fan of the way Zach treats everybody else that works for him. He's kind of a douche. I'm definitely going to check out the Halloween special. But I am kind of curious about the little miniseries too, because serial killers have been a big thing for decades. They're going to go to a prison cell that once housed John Wayne Gacy. They're going to check out the house of H.H. Holmes, who was believed to be the first American serial killer. And then they're also going to go to Squirrel Cage Jail, which once was the residence of Jake Bird. So they've got a few names that are, their stories are worth investigating and being retold, but also they're not gonna talk to these people as ghosts. It's just not gonna happen. That's not gonna happen. And if they claim that that's happening, right, then fuck them, because it's bullshit.
Make some cool special effects up if you're faking it. We don't care if you feel a presence from the inside and your stomach burns. Stop eating enchiladas, motherfucker.
Some damn enchiladas.
Oh. Hey, you okay?
Some damn enchiladas.
Oh. You gonna be all right?
Zach, why are you sweating? I don't know. I must be possessed by something. No, the AC doesn't work in this house. It hasn't been occupied for 60 years. It's fucking hot. It's Arizona.
You're possessed by Del Taco, motherfucker.
Yeah, you shouldn't have gone through the Taco Bell drive-thru. You wouldn't need to take a shit for the 2 hours that you're on the air.
Yeah, I'm telling you, they're fucking full of shit, man. I took the fucking Bobby Mackey's ghost tour, all right? Mm-hmm. I live close enough to that motherfucker where I can actually go to it. And there's you know how they said they could feel shit there. Even on the ghost tour, they're like, don't provoke the spirits. So what the fuck did I do? I was talking shit the whole way through it, under my breath, trying to get some shit to start. Honestly, nothing happened.
No.
I'm telling you, they're fucking frauds, man. I can't stand them Ghost Adventures assholes.
Behind you, dude.
Oh, no, that's just my buddy. Don't worry about Josh. He's cool.
He's all right? All right.
Yeah.
But yeah, Ghost Adventures is going to be taking over the month of October on the Travel Channel. It looks kind of fun if you're into that show. So stay tuned and check it out.
Open the fucking box.
I saw you with the box. Who's in the box?
What's in the box?
What's in the fucking box?
Give me the gun.
He just told you.
Next up on Stories Around the Campfire, I got the opportunity to go to Oklahoma City on July 20th and check out Nightfall Haunted Territories. First horror con. I think it's something they're going to try to do every year. This one was kind of small. Didn't have a whole lot going on. No panels. They had some haunted walkthroughs. I had like a little forest built in this arena that we were in. And then they had a couple of guests that were there doing autographs and photo ops. They had Ari Lehman, which I was able to visit. And we also got to get an autograph from Phyllis Rose. And also got an autograph from Edward Furlong, who, you know, is going to be in the new Terminator Dark Fate movie. I know that doesn't have anything to do with what we're talking about, but he was in Pet Sematary too, so it was cool to have him.
And Brain Scan.
Yes, and Brain Scan.
Don't forget that classic.
Yeah. It was a lot of fun, though. It was a good time. It was, like I said, it was small. I met a lot of new people. Got some good stuff. Put together this little short sizzle reel. The favorite thing that I saw there the entire time was one of the screen-used vehicles in Christine. So, and it is featured prominently in our little sizzle reel. Check this out, and we'll be right back.
Me and Colonel weren't there. Didn't happen.
That's right.
In wide wonder at the joy they had found. The head nurse spoke up, said, "Leave this one alone." She could tell right away that I was bad to the bone. Bad to the bone. Bad to the bone. Bad. 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 Bad to the bone.
Oh, hell yeah. The Christine car.
Fuck this shit, I'm out.
Please say that you will.
Say you will.
Red Crank with Death First Society here live on site in Oklahoma City at Nightfall Haunted Territory.
Campers, this is Ori Lehman, the first Jason Voorhees from Friday the 13th.
Hey, this is Eddie Furlong, you're watching Death Curse Society.
And you're watching Death Curse Society. Jason never dies.
Glass. So yeah, I got a little creeped out in the Christine car. I had to get the hell out of there real quick. But yeah, it was a lot of fun. I enjoyed the show, and hopefully they'll be doing another one soon. We're going to check it out next year, hopefully. Guys, you got any questions, or Colonel?
I just want to know, who's your favorite celebrity you met? Because Felisa's a sweetheart. Mm-hmm. Ari's a really cool guy to get along with. I'm just kind of curious who you enjoyed.
I probably literally got along better with Felisa Rose because at one point we were standing there and her booth was right next to Edward Furlong, and this guy walks in with this Terminator bust, like the robotic head, skull, glowing eyes and everything. It was beautiful, and both of us are just like, awestruck. And I'm still standing there trying to get an autograph from her, and she's just like, I've got to get a photo of this. And I'm like, yeah, go get a photo, you know, and I just kind of stood there and watched the table for her for a little bit, and she's over there talking with Eddie, and people are coming up, and they're like, where is she? And I'm like, she's right there, you know? She's literally right there. They're like, well, how much are autographs? And I was like, oh, it's this and this and this, and Felicia's assistant is sitting there on her phone like, damn, this guy, you want my job, you know? And so we had a good little exchange there. It was pretty fun, but Ari was cool too. Honestly, Edward Furlong looked like he would have rather been anywhere else than, you know, 100-degree heat Oklahoma. But, you know, he was having a good time with some of the fans. And you know, as you saw, he did a little dance for us there at the end.
There's not enough horror cons. It can never be enough. And just my only hope is it gets big enough to where my ass can come over there from Detroit. So go big. Haunted houses are huge, man. So that's a good avenue to be a part of, to be a partner with.
While it wasn't Nightfall, I was able to pick up this geographic-specific shirt for horror fans. You know, it's got the state of Oklahoma horror fan, but it's a cleaver of some kind. You know, and it's pretty slick. If you're an Oklahoma resident and you are interested, you can pick it up from Crazed Lemming Productions. Check them out at crazedlemming.com. Last couple things we want to talk about in Stories Around the Campfire is last Friday we did a live game stream where we played Friday the 13th for 5.5 hours and talked about all the San Diego Comic-Con horror content. Yeah, we kept Colonel up late. Colonel, you want to talk to him about that?
Oh, man, that was a blast. That took me back to about 2.5, well, just shy of 2.5 years ago when I met you gentlemen playing said game. Oh, it's been way too long to have that long of a gaming session. Just have fun doing it. Oh, it was amazing. If you guys didn't join us, I wish you would have. We had some great conversations going. There was a lot of laughs during the conversations and even about the game.
Oh, yeah.
Just love that glitchy bastard as much today as we did on day one. Oh, it's fantastically awful, just like the Friday the 13th movies. It could not be a better Friday the 13th game.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun. We covered all kinds of topics from The Walking Dead to It Chapter 2 to the Halloween sequels that are coming out. That's one of the reasons why we're not talking about some of this news in this episode. We talked about it in the game stream, So if you're interested in it, it is annotated. Go and check it out. The link is in the description. Ziggy, what did you think of that?
Yeah, it was a blast. You know, we had a good time, and, you know, the game was secondary. The conversation took the forefront. Well, there were times that the action dictated what was going on in the game. We had to shift focus and pause what we were talking about. But, I mean, it was good. You know, and there was pretty good interactions from a few of the watchers and, you know, a few different people stepping in and out throughout the stream. So it was definitely a good time. Would love to see more people, as we had all kinds of room to talk. You know, I mean, if you play on the PlayStation 4 and you have the Friday the 13th game, come on and join us. We could use another hands in there. You know, we whacked Jason a couple of times, but mostly we were escaping, just playing it how it's meant to be played. Had a great time. Right. Had a great time.
And, yeah, well, you guys escaped. I had to be the sacrificial lamb majority of the time to get you two fucking out, so you're welcome.
Whoopsie!
Yeah.
Oh, you guys got the car started? That's cool. Let me just go get fucking slaughtered by this fucking tree.
It happens to all of us on our good days and our bad days, man.
It happens to the Colonel, not all of us. Don't let him fool you.
Necronom, Colonel.
Bullied, I'll tell you that.
But yeah, we're going to be doing a live gaming stream probably once a month most of the time. And we'll have like one big topic that we're going to kind of talk about throughout the stream. And then maybe at the end, open it up to your questions. So keep an eye out for it. Make sure to subscribe. Hit that notification bell so you know when we go live. And join us next time. We had a lot of fun. We're definitely doing it again. Another one.
Another one. Another one. Another one. Another one.
On August 9th, we're going to be doing a live special watch party subscribe-a-thon. We are going to get together, the three of us, and then we are going to watch Halloween 1978, followed immediately by Halloween 2018. We're going to break those down for you again, talk about what we liked and what we disliked about those two movies, and then we're going to spend the rest of the time speculating what we think Halloween Kills and Halloween Ends will entail. Those two movies are dropping in 2020 and 2021, right in October. That's what we've got planned for you. We're trying to open up some new avenues to get to you, the fans, and interact with you.
Yeah, I'm really looking forward to the Subscribe-a-thon. So, I mean, come on, man. We're watching two Halloween movies. We're bringing you guys live streams from video games. We bring you a weekly show. We have tons of humor, memes, cons. We're everywhere because we are you. We like different forms of entertainment like everybody else who enjoys horror. Hence, you get the wrestling references. You get the Blues Brothers. You get the fucking Family Vacation. We come at you with all kinds of weird shit in support of horror because everybody's in a bunch of weird shit. So come join us, man. It's going to be a blast.
So August 9th, it's Friday. Check it out. This means we're going to have content coming at you weekly. We're going to have a show on Thursday, and then the next Friday, we're going to be dropping a live stream on you. And then we're going to have a show the next Thursday, and then we're going to, next Friday, drop another live stream on you. It's going to be back to back to back now. We got more stuff for you. We want you to come along for the DCS ride. Woo! We'll be back to wrap up the show right after this. Stick around.
Never, ever, ever, under any circumstances, say, I'll be right back, because you won't be back.
I'm getting another beer. You want one?
Yeah, sure.
I'll be right back!
They're coming to get you, Barbara.
Stop it! You're ignorant!
They're coming for you, Barbara.
Stop it! You're acting like a child!
Look, they're coming for you. Look! There comes one of them now!
Nothing. You know, it's funny. Everybody fears the inevitable. Everybody fears what's coming in the end, the uncertainty. Everybody fears death. I find calm in death. You know why I find calm in death? Because every living creature on this planet faces it one day or another. No one can escape death. It's almost like we have a death curse. I know one thing before I leave this planet, and that curse ultimately takes me. I want to join a society of like-minded people, but I also fear and embrace the inevitable. Indianapolis. Death is coming to your small town, September 6th through the 8th. I ask everyone to embrace the curse and join the society. Are you DCS?
He'll hear you.
Here he comes now. I'm getting out of here.
Johnny!
Society gang, we're gonna wrap up the show real quick. I would like to start off by saying thank you, special thanks to Phil Mora and Wondershare for their great program that we use to edit all of this stuff together. Wouldn't be possible without them and their assistance in letting us get this, our hands on this program. If you need it, check it out at wondershare.filmora.com.
Remember, I was telling you about those great content we have coming your way. There's multiple ways to see it. We have links to everything we do on YouTube, on our Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Also, if you happen to miss any of this that's live, go over to our website, deathcursesociety.com, and keep up with everything we put out if you missed anything. I do understand some people have lives. You might not be able to dedicate 6 hours on a Friday night to watching Halloween. What fucking else could you be doing better than that? I don't know, but some people might have an excuse.
Look at this fine logo here in Crank's scene right up here, right here. You can get that on the t-shirt, and then you just buy one. Here you get to do paypal.me/zigzagisDCS. I've got you hooked up. I got the smalls through the extra large. Cost you $20. Shipping's included. And then the 2X and up, we got you all the way to the 5X. It's going to cost you an extra $5. You understand why. I won't even say it. But that's where you get your DCS shirt, and then you too can indeed show the world that you are indeed DCS.
All right, our next episode is going to be August 15th. We're going to be talking about Colonel's favorite movie of 2019, Scary Stories to Tell in the Dark. And we're also going to be talking about this beauty right here from the writer of Friday the 13th, Victor Miller, and the director of Child's Play, the original Child's Play, Tom Holland. Rock, Paper, Scissors is finally out on DVD. I got my copy yesterday, and boom! I even got two copies, so you know what? One of these is coming to one of you viewers out there. Tune in 2 weeks, and you can figure out how to win. For the Colonel and for Zig Zag, this is Red Crank saying DCS out. See you next time. Woo!
DCS out. What?
Woo!
1 of those same things. It's those movies where you find yourself holding your breath, you know, in people see.
I was trying to get a warning when I went like this. Like,
you can say it.
I fuck this shit, I'm out. I fuck this shit, I'm out. So, yeah.